Okay, so the next major topic is functions. So Python allows you to create functions. It is extremely easy to do. So let's get started. Why do you need functions? First thing, why don't we just write code like that? Why do you need functions at all? First major reason is it allows you to reduce duplication of code. So for example, let us say you have to convert some quantity into say a number. Take for example the integer. When I did int of 29, someone has implemented this functionality somewhere. Int of 29 will return an integer. Somebody has written that functionality. Imagine that every time I encountered the string, I have to sit and write 10 lines of code to convert this silly string to an integer. So what have they done for me? By providing this one function int, in this case int is not a function actually, but supposing they did provide this function called int, it would convert that function nicely, it will convert that quantity nicely in one line of code rather than 10 lines of code. So it essentially allows you to remove any duplication. So if somebody, anybody else wants to do the conversion, they just call this function with the corresponding arguments. A lot of things that we have done so far, we have used convenience methods like join, split. All of that functionality is essentially abstracted out into functions. So therefore, it reduces duplication of code. You need fewer lines of code, and therefore, it also reduces bugs. So let's imagine you have a big project and you took the naive approach of copying all this. You write this function once, you write those 10 lines and you copy the 10 lines to 20 different functions. You find a mistake. Now what do? You have to go to every one of those 20 files and change every one of them. Instead, if I wrote one function, I fix the error in that one function, everybody else also gets the fix. So it reduces duplication, fewer lines of code and hence less scope of bugs. It allows other people to reuse your function. And the nice thing is, if I write, so we didn't care about what the integer fellow wrote. When I said int of 29, I didn't care what he did. It works. So I don't care about those details. So I can use other people's function without knowing the nitty gritty of their implementation. So which means it helps me manage my programming tasks become much easier. Okay. So we need to create functions. Let's see what we can do. So let's say we want to create the function f of x such that it squares the argument of x, the argument provided, and returns the result. So that is, I want to return x squared. To write this in Python, you simply do the following: def, which is a keyword, f x, and then everything that is indented one level is the content of this function. So if I say, by the way, if you want to give comments, use the hash key, it will give you comments in Python. Now, if I do f of 1, it printed hey and it returned 1. So I could say, for example, x is f of 1, x is okay. So long as I am able to do multiplication between the two elements x, I can call the function f. So if it is an integer, a float, so for example, let me create a complex number f of 1, okay. Is this clear? So basically I can create a function with just these three lines, with def, f is the function name, x is an argument that is passed to the function followed by a colon which defines the block of the function. To return a value, you simply use return. But if you do not want to return, for example, if I want to say def f of x, I do not want to do anything, I can simply say pass, and then f of 1 will do nothing. Or I can say def f of x print x, it will simply print the value. you do not have to return anything, but if you want to return something, you may do so. So, recapping, def is a keyword, f is the name of the function, x is the parameter of the function, and return is also a keyword that specifies what should be returned. So, it is as simple as that. So, here is another function, as I had shown you, greet print hello world. So, greet is also a function, and notice that greet does not take any arguments. So, you do not necessarily have to take arguments. However, if I called f now with an argument, what do you think I should get? F does not take any arguments, but I did not, I am saying f of 1. It will give me a nice error message. It will say f takes no arguments, you have given me 1. Similarly, if I define def f of x, and now I called f with no arguments, it will tell me f takes 1 argument, you have only given me, you have given me nothing, 0 given. So, the error message once again is extremely helpful. Now, supposing I have a function in this case f printed 1, but did f return anything? Let us find out. So, x is equal to f of 1. What was f? Now, x is equal to f of 1 notice that x is something called none. None is a special quantity in Python which is somewhat similar to null in C or C++. Okay. It basically says it is nothing. Okay, and it is commonly used. There are many situations where none is a useful quantity that we have. So, the question is, if not using IPython, we should after def statement in the next line press one tab key. Well, you can use tab, but I would suggest you use spaces. Use 4 spaces ideally, then the code becomes visually pleasing to look at. So, after the colon, you should always do spaces. It is a good idea. Okay, so, moving on. You can give multiple arguments, as many arguments as you want you can give, all separated by commas. So, in this case average of A and B will be A plus B by 2 in this case. Okay. So, I can do calculate the average of 12 and 10, fairly simple. Now, one important convention that is followed in most Python, good Python code is to write what is called doc strings or documentation strings. So, it is highly recommended that all functions should be documented. So, we write a doc string along with the function definition. So, let's try this. Now, if I do average of 12 and 10, it is 11, but what is average? Remember when I did average question mark, it exactly gives me that help. Notice, returns the average of the two numbers supplied as input. Okay? So, the IPython magic will work for every function you define, but if you did not write it for my f function, I did not supply a doc string, there is no documentation. Therefore, it is a very good idea for you to supply documentation in a part of your functions. Every time you write a function, please supply a document string by default. Okay, you should always do it. So, now we know how to create functions that return nothing or return something. How do you return multiple things? Turns out it is very easy. So, let us say you have a circle function in this case, and I want to return both the area and perimeter. Given a radius, return area and perimeter. So, in this case I am saying pi is 3.14, area is pi is obviously not 3.14, I am approximating it. This is wrong code, but just to illustrate the idea of a function, area is pi r squared, perimeter is 2 pi r. And notice that the return is simply return area comma perimeter. Okay. So, what will happen here is, if I call circle 4, nothing will happen. So, let's try this. This is a bad doc string, I should have written it better. Pi is not even that, but I do not remember too much. Notice that it returns a tuple, but I can say A comma P is circle 6, for example. So, it allows us to return multiple values, and you can return as many things as you want. And you are not constrained to return. So, supposing you have a function that has a conditional. For example, you say if r is positive, do something, return two values, if r is negative, return one value. You can do anything you want, basically. You can return nothing, you can return something. It is completely up to you on how the function is written. Okay. So, I will quickly recap what we have learnt on functions. Creating a function is as simple as saying def function name. Please note that the function name, like variable names in Python, have to be a standard form. They cannot start with a digit. For example, this is illegal, it's invalid syntax. Whereas AS12 is a reasonable variable name. A function name should be a reasonable variable name. So, alpha numeric characters, you must not start with a numeric. It cannot contain dot. For example, I cannot say P dot A S is 1. Okay, that is a syntax error. So, you can do alpha numeric and underscore. No white space, no comma, semicolon, all of those are not allowed. Just standard. Okay. So, any of those names are supported. Def f, any number of arguments or no arguments, optionally return. You should supply a argument, a doc string. And you can return multiple quantities by basically return, you could return a list or you could return a tuple like this, area comma perimeter. Now that you know this, take 2 minutes and try to guess what this function does. I will give you exactly 2 minutes time. Please try and figure out what this function does. So, does anybody have the answer? What does this function do? Assume that n is an integer. You may assume that n is an integer. What is passed is an integer. So, everybody is saying that if argument is odd, it returns false, and in case of even number, it returns true. Then what is all that division by 10 and all that? Why you do all that? Why do you need a while loop? Odd and even, I can simply do n percentage 2 is equal to 1. If n percentage 2 is 1, there is a remainder, then it is odd. If n percentage 2 is 0, it is even. Why do I need all that while loop? If n is negative, all of that, why do you need all of that? So, think before you answer. This is not a trivial question. Just typing out the answer is going to give you a negative response. No output. You should get negative 10, minus 100 marks. No output means no input so far. Okay. So, let me help you this time. The next question, I will not help you. very good. So, you are getting close, separate into digits if it is even. So, if n is an integer and assuming it is in a decimal number system, obviously, if n is less than 0, make n minus n, which means if it's negative, it will convert the number to a positive number. Simple. Then whenever n is greater than 0, which means you are going to keep dividing by 10, so at one point it will become less than, it will become less than 10, and dividing that will become 0. So long as it is greater than 10, greater than 0, check if the number is odd or even. A number is odd or even purely you can determine by the last digit. So, if the last digit is odd, the last digit is even, it will be divisible by 2. The last digit is odd, it will not be divisible by 2. So, if any of the digits of that number is odd, it will return false. If every digit of that number is even, it will return true. So, why? Because when n is greater, so let us say we have n is 123, n is positive, so this if condition will not be handled. Please note this, it is possible instead of having to say colon next line, you can say it in one line itself. If n less than 0 colon, you can give it a single expression, single statement here. So, while n is positive, so n is now 123, n percentage 2 is equal to 1, 123 divided by 2 is, 123 modulo 2 is 1. So, it will return false. But what if it is 122? Okay, 122, it is not false. So, it comes to this line, it will divide it by 2 by 10, what do you get? 122 by 10 is 12. 122 by 10, integer division, remember they are all integers. So, it is 10, sorry, it is 12. Now, it will go back through the while loop, it will again check, 12 is divisible by 2, yes, again it will divide. What do you have left? N is now 1, is n greater than 0? Yes, it will go to this, n divided by 2 is, n modulo 2 is 1, so it is false, so it will return false. So, even though 122 is even, the answer is false because the digit 1 is even. So, basically this function checks if every digit of this integer is even or odd. If there is one, if all digits are even, it will return true. That is all this function does. And this is why it is important that you document functions, right? Now, this is your chance to redeem yourself. Tell me what this function does. It's very easy. Again, assume n is an integer and assume n is a positive integer, no problem. So, there is no need to write down this code, just look at it, interpret it line by line. So, the function what takes one argument called n. N is an integer. So, you are running the program for different input is not what I am looking for. That the computer will do very nicely for me. The exercise here is not that you run this for 5 different cases and tell me what it does for everyone. You have to be able to read code. If you are a programmer, it is important that you be able to read code and understand it line by line. If not, how are you going to debug your own problems? When you debug, when you have a problem, there is no way you will know anything unless you are able to read it and find mistakes and understand the flow of logic, you cannot do anything. But what if it, so it finds if it is a perfect square or not, and then find the nearest possible perfect square, correct? So basically it is going to iterate, start at I is equal to 1. Check if I squared is less than n, if I squared is less than n, increment I, if it is equal to n, what happens? It will break out of this, return true comma the square root of that number. So, what if it is less than, but it has become greater than it, then it will be false and that number. So, it will give me the next nearest perfect square that is higher than this number, and if it is a perfect square, it will return true comma its square root, or false comma nearest square root of a number that is larger than this number that is a perfect square. Okay. So, the point of this exercise is that you should be in a comfortable position that you are able to understand enough Python to be able to read simple code fragments like this. So, in Python, you notice many of the functions and methods that we used had default arguments. So, can you give me one example? It is already there in your screen. Round took one argument and a number of digits as an optional argument. Optional arguments are typically called default arguments in Python. So, round, for example, you said 2.484 will give you 2.4, round 2.4842 will give you 2.48. So, the idea is this 2 is an optional parameter. For this, how do you create functions? The question that we are trying to answer here is, how do you create a function that you create which has optional arguments? Another example is split, where you gave it an optional argument, range, which had multiple optional arguments. Okay. So, how would you implement these? So, the syntax is def, same as before, welcome is the name of the function, some say example. First argument, this is not optional. So, when I call this function, I have to supply greet, because this function does not know what greet is. However, name is equal to word, world means the argument world name is optional and it defaults to world. So, to understand this better, let us try it as an example. So, if I say welcome, hi, it says hi world. If I say welcome, hi, Guido, who is the creator of the language, it says hi Guido. Okay. So, the point here is, if I do not supply a second argument, it will treat that second argument name as world. If not, it will just take the first argument that you supply. What if I did welcome without any arguments? What error should you get? You should get type error saying I expect at least one argument, you have given me 0, because greet has no default value. So, it does not know what to do. One thing very important is default argument should always come at the end. They cannot come in the starting of the function. This is illegal syntax. Okay. So, if you try it, it will give you an error. So, remember default arguments always come towards the end. Now, default arguments have a little bit more to them than just defaults. In Python, the more general way of calling arguments is called keyword arguments. So, in this same case, let us go back to the example that we had. Our function was, this was our function. Welcome greet, name is world, print greet comma name, simple function. Now, if I say hello Jim, welcome, this will say hi James, no problem. But now, if I say welcome, hi, name equals Prabhu, it gives me hi Prabhu. So, which means I can say welcome default some argument and a named argument I can say name is this. In addition, I can say welcome greet equals hi, name is Prabhu. Is this clear? So, the actual argument name can also be used to specify how you call the function. Okay. In addition, now that I know the name, the order does not matter. If I am going to specify all the arguments by name, I know everything. It's obvious as to whether it is, which parameter is what becomes obvious. So I can say, welcome, name is Prabhu, greet is hello. So once you specify all the arguments in terms of keyword arguments, the position of those arguments does not matter. Okay. However, if I were to do this, what do you think will happen? This will give me an error, because keyword argument should always come at the last. So if I have any positional arguments like this, which do not have a specific name, they cannot, they should only come first. So the syntax is, given a function, call any positional arguments. These are all these fellows without any name, name equals, greet equals, that is called the name, that is the keyword. If you do not specify a keyword, you have to specify them first. Is this clear? So this is important. So always positional arguments come first. Positional arguments are unadorned, they are just x, y, z, a, b, c. It is not of the form argument name equal to some value. Okay. For example, let me give you an even simpler example. Def f x comma y equals 2, print x comma y. I can call f 1 comma 2, that is fine. I can call f 1, that is fine. I can say f y equals 1 illegal, because I have not given x. I cannot do this. But I can do this. So all the positional arguments should come first, keyword arguments come last. But if I am specifying everything as keyword arguments, I can do f of y equals 1, x equals 2, no problem. Okay. So let me make it a little more complicated. So maybe that will clarify things. Def f x y equals 2, z equals 3. F of 1 will be 1, 2, 3, f of x equals 11, y equals 2, this is legal, because I know every argument, I know explicitly what every argument's value is, but this is illegal. Why? Because I specified a positional argument after a keyword argument, which is illegal. You cannot do that. Okay. So, what Python lets you do, a quick recap. You can create a function using the syntax def, function name, arguments, optional return. You need not return. If you do not return, by default, the return value is assumed to be none. None is equivalent to C is null. You must provide a doc string as a convenience to yourself and your users. The way to do that is to use a triple quoted string and put documentation relevant to this function here. Comments, by the way, are written using a hash. There are no multi-line comments. Only single line comments. Comments can also be in the same, you can have inline comments. Okay. The upshot is, if you put doc strings, you can use the question mark feature for your own functions in IPython. You can return multiple values by separating them by a comma. Here are simple examples for you to read and understand functions. You can supply default arguments to any of the arguments. you must always specify the default arguments last. Everything can have a default argument, but if you have some which are positional like greet, keyword arguments should only follow them. Then you can call the function like so, in which case greet will be equal to hi and name will be equal to Guido. If you say welcome hello, it will be the default will be used, so you will get hello world. Keyword arguments is essentially an extension of the same idea. The idea is if you say welcome greet name is world, I could explicitly say welcome hello James, but this is kind of, it is not clear what hello is and what James is. So I can say welcome greet equals hello, name equals James, that is all legal. I can say welcome hi, name equals Guido, or what I had said, or you can swap the arguments, name is Guido, greet is same, but this you cannot do. You must always specify the keyword arguments last and not first. So any questions on the function stuff that we learned so far? Question is, can we have recursion with Python functions? The answer is yes, but there is a recursion limit. Only 0 has all the bits even. Why? Why not 222? The number 222 has all the bits, all the digits even. It is not a question of all the bits, it is a question of all the digits of that number being even. So if you go back, let us go through the example. If I give you 22, it comes here, percentage 2 is not false, so it is divided by 2, again not false, divided by 2, it becomes 0 and returns true, that is it. So it exits the while loop because n is no longer greater than 0. You get true for 150 also, that is not possible. Because if you look at 150, you must have entered the code wrongly. N is positive. Is there any reference variable in? Okay, so I will first answer question on if n is greater than 0. So if it is 150, it is divisible by 2, so it will not return false, it will divide. Then it will be 150 divided by 2, which has a remainder of 1, so it should return false. So unless you have made a mistake in your own typing. So not only have you not understood the function, you have also typed the function wrong is what I say. So two more questions, is there any reference variable in Python? I do not understand what you mean. Are you saying, are there, can you call something by reference and things like that? Basically in Python, you can think of everything as a reference. Okay. So as a simple example, if you switch to this terminal, if I say A is 1, 2, 3, I say B is A, and if I now change A of 0, B is also changed. So essentially, don't get confused with pointers. In Python, the names you see, this B, this A, they are all names. So the way you should think of the world, universe in Python is that there are these objects like 1, 2, 3, this list, all of these quantities are objects. And these names you see here A, B, all of them are names that are connected to those objects. So they are names of that object. For example, if you look at me, this person is Prabhu. One of my names is Prabhu. My mother may call me son. My father may call me son. If I have a child, my child may call me father. They are all different names, but they refer to the same entity. So in Python, it is similar. They are not pointers, but they are essentially names that are bound to objects. Okay. So do not get confused with pointers, pointer arithmetic. There are no pointers in Python. The next question is how to write a floating point number in a file. Well, if you want to make sure that it is accurate, you need to write out all the digits, but it is a very inefficient way to write it. There are other functions provided by other libraries like say NumPy, which will allow you to write. So, there is a mechanism by which you can do save. If you have a NumPy array, it will let you save it. The third question is, do we have Par4 like MATLAB? Well, you have lots of things better than Par4 and some things worse than Par4. I do not know what exactly Par4 is, but I am assuming that it is a parallel for. So, first thing is parallelization is a non-trivial issue and there are no simple default mechanisms to deal with parallelization in Python. There is support for MPI, there is support for multiprocessing, there is a whole variety of things that you can possibly do. But it is not there is no one-to-one correspondence between MATLAB and Python. So, there are certain things that you can do in Python very easily, certain things you can do in MATLAB very easily. But remember that MATLAB is just a numerical processing language. The third question is, can we use AND in conditions? Yes. I had already discussed this in the section on Booleans. So, if you have true and false, the result will be false. So, if you have two conditionals, for example, I say A is 1. So, I can say A is greater than 0 and A is not equal to 0, that is true. So, yes, you can use AND or NOT, all of those can certainly be used. Can we override the library functions provided by Python? Yes, you can, but I would suggest you do not. So, generally the way in which you do some of these things is to make sure that you do not override certain built-ins that you are used to. Okay. And built-ins are limited, there is other functionality that is provided beyond the built-ins. For example, we will look later, there is something you can create called modules. When you create a module, you can actually shadow or modify to a sense. When you import functionality from a module, you can call it whatever name you want. So, it could be a name that is already built in. However, that module allows you to define it in a particular scope and therefore, it gives you some ability to deal with this. And trust me, it is not a big problem because sometimes if you get into a bug, you realize that oh, you have overridden a method or a function that is provided by a library. But most often you can figure it out, it is not too difficult to figure out when you get into this problem. But yes, Python is flexible enough that you can override a library function provided by it. There are some technical details about it that I do not want to get into and I shall not get into. So, the answer that I am giving you is not 100% accurate, but it should serve for the purposes of this course. So, let us continue where we left off. We have seen all of this. We have looked at default arguments and keyword arguments and so far no one has had questions, so I am going to skip it. If you have more questions, I guess you can ask us on the chat session on Moodle. I am going to move on to try and finish as much as I can of this material today. There are several built-in functions and some of which you have already seen. So, there is ABS, there is any, there is all, length, max, min. You have not seen all, but many of the other functions you have seen. And as you have seen before, it is easy to figure out what these functions do by doing question mark. Similarly, there are functions called POW is power, there is range you have already seen, sum you have seen, type you have seen. All of these are, there is more information on all of these functions at this URL that is supplied. The slides are available and you can find these. So, let us look at some more nitty gritty details about functions before we move on to dictionaries and sets. The first thing you have to understand about functions is that all the arguments are local. So, if you try this simple example, def change q equals 10 or okay, sorry, q equals 10 print q, and now let us say I have q equals 1. The q that is defined here has nothing to do with the q that has been passed here as an argument. So, if I say change 100, it still prints only 10 because the q that is defined here is completely local to this function. However, if I print q here, it still prints 1. So, understand that arguments and variables that are introduced inside a function scope are purely local. Okay. So, similarly, you can look here, if n is 5, def change, so let us try this. This will print 10, and if I print 10, it is still 5. So, which means the variable that is introduced here inside this function is completely local inside here. However, if I define the function like this, in this case, it will print 5. The reason is, now if let us say, now let us say n is equal to 125, what happens is, if a variable is not found inside the function scope, it goes to the scope that is containing this function and looks for a variable of that name. If that variable is not available, so to delete say the existence of n here, I can say del n, in which case if I do change, it will say name error, global name n is not defined. However, there are often times when you need to change a variable that is global, in which case there is a special keyword called global. So, let us say n is 5, I say def change, and now I want to be able to change the n that is in the global namespace. If I did n is equal to 10 here, as you saw before, it is only going to create a new variable in this namespace of the function. It is not going to actually modify the global n. So, if you want to do that, you simply say global n, and now if you say n is 10, print 10. It will print 10, and if I print 10 here, it will also become 10. So, you have to use global if ever you need to deal with global variables, but using global variables is usually a bad idea, and it suggests that your code is actually not very well written. Okay. So, there is one little detail that you have to keep in mind with functions. In Python, if any of the arguments that you supply are mutable, that is, if you supply a list, it does not make a copy. Therefore, let us try this little example, name is say Mr. Steve Gosling, and if I say def change, oops, and now if I say name 0 is doctor, and I say change name, if I print name now, it will change the actual mutable variable that is available. Similarly, if I say change and supply an argument, and let us say x dot append, and now if I say change name, oops, now as you see, it says Dr. Steve Gosling, creator of Java. So, the point is, if you pass a quantity that is mutable into a function and you change that inside the function, it is going to change the object that you passed in. Obviously, this does not hold for mutable, immutable objects, because immutable objects cannot be changed, in which case it is going to make a copy. So, if I pass in a string, say, there is nothing you can do about it. So, this is something that you have to keep in mind when you pass functions, when you pass arguments to functions. So, let me quickly summarize some of these issues. The first thing is that arguments that you supply inside a function are completely local. So, if you create a shadow variable, say q is 10 here, or you pass an argument q, this q is completely local to this namespace. Okay. So, if you assign a new quantity to it, it does not change any q that is in the namespace that is containing the function. Similarly, if you use variables inside the function, they are completely local to that function. However, if you define a variable, or if you use a variable inside a function that is not defined in that function, it will look for the same variable in the containing scope. Okay. So, in this case, it will look for an n that is outside the change. If you want to change the global variable, you must use the global keyword. Finally, you have to remember that if it is a mutable argument, the mutable argument is passed essentially by reference, and therefore you can change it inside the function, and the changes will be visible to the actual object that was passed. So with that, we finish a brief introduction to functions. As with all programming languages, the way to learn more about it is to actually program more. We will try and give you some programming assignments over the course of the next week. So moving on, so far I have conveniently not talked about tuples at all. So to create a tuple, as you recall, is as easy as using parentheses. So you have parentheses 1, 2.5, hello. So just like lists, tuples can also contain objects of different types. They do not all have to be the same type. So here we have an integer, a floating point, a string, another integer, so on and so forth. In this case, t is actually a tuple. Now notice that it is not always necessary to use parentheses. So when I say a is equal to 1 comma 2 comma 3, implicitly it becomes a tuple. So if I say a is 1 comma 2 comma 3, then the type of this is a tuple. So what's so different about a tuple? Well, accessing the elements is the same. So if I say a of 0, a of 1, all of that is fine. However, I can also do slices and all of that. So if I say a of 0 is equal to 100, it will not allow you to do it. So the problem with the good thing and the bad thing about tuples is that they are immutable. So if you want to create an immutable collection, for whatever reason, you would use a tuple. So one interesting thing about tuples is that it allows, there is something called tuple unpacking. So when I do a comma b equals 1 comma 2, what is actually happening is it is doing what is called tuple unpacking. So when I do 1 comma 2, it actually creates a tuple. On the left hand side again there are two quantities. So this is what is called tuple unpacking. When I do this, if I say print a comma b, it will be 1 comma 2. Okay. So in Python, therefore, supposing I have a is 1, b is 2. If I want to swap the two quantities, I can do a comma b equals b comma a. Notice that there is no need for a temporary variable. Okay. This is one very interesting and convenient thing to do with swapping variables in Python. It is just one single line, no need for all this complicated storing it in a temporary and all of that, it is all unnecessary. So this is again the same concept, tuple unpacking. So with this we finish tuples. They are not quite used beyond that context in this course too much, but you will keep encountering tuples, and they are like any other sequence. You can basically iterate through them, you can check for containership, you can access the elements. However, you cannot set the elements, that is all. The next major important data structure in Python is what are called dictionaries. Dictionaries are extremely powerful and extremely useful. So with lists, if you remember, if I had 1, a, c, a of 0 is 1, a of 1 is a of 2 is c. Now supposing I wanted to create a data structure where the index that I am supplying, this a of 0, instead of 0, that I could give it actually a key. Let us say I could say a of something or a of a. Okay. Lists unfortunately do not allow for this. A dictionary is precisely such a data structure. What you can do is, so look at this example, this is how you create an empty dictionary. The dictionary. Now, if I want to create a key value store, for example, here is a set of extensions JPG colon JPEG image. So, let me type a simpler example. Use the curly brace JPG Notice that the keys need not be strings alone. So I can say 1 is Notice now that we have this nice dictionary. So, now if I say ext of 1, it gives me 1, ext of jpg tells me jpeg, ext of data is 1, 2, 3. So, notice that it gives me the ability to associate two different quantities. Okay. One is called the key. So, what I supply inside this square bracket is called the key, okay, and what is returned by that is called the value. Okay. Please note that in all of the, in this data structure, there is no ordering. In a list, there is 0, 1, 2, 3. So, here there is no ordering, there is no guarantee that 1 is going to be before or after. Okay. The ordering is completely internal and you should not rely on any of the ordering. So, what you need to think of when you think of dictionaries is that it is basically an association of keys and values. So, let us say you want to create an address book, okay, where you want to index it based on the person's name. So, I will say Prabhu Ramachandran colon supply whatever data, his address or something like that, or his phone number. Okay. Things like that can be done with a dictionary. So, how do you access elements? As I had shown you in the example, use the dictionary, use the same operator, bracket operator, and supply the key. So, the values can be accessed using the keys. The values of non-existent keys cannot obviously be accessed. So, for example, let us say ext of bash, we will say key error, there is no such key, bash key does not exist. So, how do I find out all the keys? You can say ext dot keys. Okay, this gives you all the keys, and ext dot values will give you all the values. Okay. So, if I want to add a new value, so if I say ext of cpp, I can set it to a new value as C++ say. And now you notice that in the data structure, this C++ code has been added, CPP C++ code has been added. Okay. To remove it, you can say del ext. So, let us say I want to remove this 1. Notice that in this, everything else is a string. The only key that is a non-string is this 1. So, let me say I want to remove it. So, I can say del ext of 1. Now, let us print ext. Okay. So, this is similar to a list. So, if I have a list say A, if I want to delete the first element of A, I can say del A of 0. Similarly, del ext of 1 or say del ext of data, or let us say CPP will remove. Now, in addition, just like this, the notion of containership also exists. So, which means if I want to say data in ext, the answer is true. But if I say jpeg in ext, it will say false. So, you have to understand that when I do this containership checking, it only checks for the keys. Okay? It does not check for the values. So, how would you check for the values? Well, I could do jpeg in ext dot values, and that will be true. Okay? However, containership of a dictionary is only for checking the keys. So, as I have already told you, extensions dot keys will give you all the keys, dot values will give you all the values. And you must note that the order that is given by the keys itself is arbitrary. So, there is no sorting, or there may be sorting, but you cannot rely on it. However, the order of the values and the order of the keys will be the same, they will be in the same order. The other useful thing about extension of the dictionaries is that I can write code like this. So, which means I can iterate over the keys of a dictionary. So, notice that the same pattern is used. It is used in lists, it is used in tuples, it is used in strings, it is used for files, and it is also used for dictionaries. So, the same pattern. So, therefore, it becomes very easy to write and read such code. So, So, for each in extensions dot keys, print each extensions each, or for each in extensions, you can do the same thing. With that, we finish dictionaries. Please note that dictionaries are an extremely powerful data structure. So, please look at ext.tab and you will see that it has a variety of methods. Please experiment with these and explore these in your spare time. We will obviously not be able to go through every single one of these, and it is also not important that you need to know every one of these. The point being, if you are ever in doubt, just start up a Python interpreter, create a new dictionary and then type d.tab and experiment and learn for yourself. So, if you want to say, I want to see from keys question mark, it will tell you what it is. And then you can experiment, play around, learn about it and go back. This is why you actually never need a manual. You can just learn Python by using just the interpreter and the documentation that is available online and built-in documentation. We now move to the last data structure that we will cover in basic Python, which is sets. Sets are again a data type that have been introduced recently in Python. I think 2.5 onwards, sets are available as a built-in data structure. So, let us see how we can create a set. So, consider this list. So, A is equal, now if I want to create a set A, given any sequence, type of AL is a list, type of A is a set. So, what is the property of a set? Supposing there are repeated elements in a set, will it show you all of the repeated elements? No, it will only show you one for each occurrence. So, let us see what set has. So, set has only the unique elements. Notice that in the list, 1 is repeated as is 2, whereas in the set, you only see 1, 2, 4, 5 and 6. So, the repetition is gone. So, conceptually, it is identical to the sets that are used in mathematics. Duplicate elements are not allowed and there is no necessary order of the elements. So, let us consider two sets. F10 is set. Notice that you have to give it a sequence. Now, let us look at some interesting operations that we can perform. These are the two sets we have. First is, we can do the union. So, F10 union P10. So, when you put the OR, you get the union of the two sets. So, in this case, it should be 1, 2, 3, 5, 7, 8, which is correct. F and P10 will be the intersection. The difference will be F minus P10, which will be 1 and 8. The symmetric difference will be 1, 7 and 8. Therefore, such operations can be easily defined on sets. In addition, one can look at subsets, proper subsets. So, for example, if I have B is set, is B less than equal to F10? Yes. Is B less than equal to P10? No. Why? Because P10 does not contain 1. So, how do you say one set is contained? So, B contained in F10? Yes. B contained in P10? False. Okay. Therefore, you have all of these basic operations of sets and you have the ability to check if something is a set, if it is a proper subset or if it is just a subset. What is the difference between proper subset and subset? Is a set a proper subset of itself? No. But is it just a subset of itself? Yes. Okay. So a proper subset is a set that has, for whom all of its elements are elements of the set that it is contained in, but whose parent set, or who the set with which it is compared, has elements that are not in B. So if I have two sets A and B, if A is a proper subset of, if A is a proper subset of B, then there exists elements in B that are not elements of A, which is not true for B and B, because every element of B is an element of A. So how do you check for containership? As usual, you can say 1 in F10, 1 in P10, okay, 4 in P10, 4 in F10. Similarly, iterating over the elements can be done as for I in F10 rent I, and notice that there is no ordering. 8 came before 1, 2, 3 and 5. So never rely on the ordering of a set. A set simply gives you a unique set of collection of elements with a bunch of very interesting operations that you can find that are very convenient. So here is a very simple example of how you can use sets. For example, given a list of marks 20, 23, 22, 23, 20, 21 and 23, list all of the duplicates. So let us say marks 20. So look at the code below, it basically says creates a set. Now this set will obviously not include any of the duplicates. So all you do is you iterate over every mark of the set and remove those marks from the original marks, then all you will be left with are the duplicates, because remove will only remove the first occurrence of that element. Does this make sense? So for mark in mark set, so for example, what will set be? M is a set of marks. M will only have 20, 21, 22 and 23. So when I iterate over all the elements of the set, the first time it will be 20, second time 21, 22, 23. So it will remove the first 20, then it will remove 21, then it will remove 22, then it will remove 23. So I will be left with one more 22, so 23, one more 20 and one more 23 here. So all of the duplicates will be remaining. Okay. But then the duplicates will be repeated. So if I want the repetitions of the duplications to be removed, I convert that to another set. Does this make sense? So if you do not understand, follow this example, I suggest that you think of how to identify the duplicates in this mark list by yourself without using sets, and then you will understand why using sets makes life so convenient. So with that, we finish the basic Python set of slides. So let us just look at some questions. Okay. So the question is, after sorting, how to remove the duplicates? Yes, to answer your question, yes, so if you want to do it without sets, you can do it. It is not doable. It is just that it is a lot harder to do it without sets. And you do not need to sort it. All you need to do is to find out whether there are duplicates in that list and list out those duplicates. So if you use sets, it becomes extremely easy to write that code, that is all. For example, one way to do the test is to take each element and count the number of occurrences. So if there is more than one occurrence, it will work, but it will be extremely inefficient to do. Whereas the code that we have written with the set is extremely efficient. Okay, so if you do the computational time complexity, you will find that it is much more efficient to do it with a set. There are many advanced issues, for example, with respect to performance, which we have not quite covered. For example, if you look at a dictionary, the dictionary access, so accessing a key value access is actually constant time. It is not linear time or logarithmic time. So PhD college has a question. Yes.
Hello.
Yes,
sir, I can hear you. I have a doubt.
Yes.
Like we are attending We are attending the workshop for totally 4 days, like yesterday and today, and 17th and 18th.
Correct. Yes.
But the participants, they will be attending on 5 weekends, isn't it, sir? Like totally,
yes.
10 days.
Yes. Yes. Because we will have a lot of exercises.
So, are the course content going to be same like what we
learned? That is the whole point. The point is we want to do the, yes, it is the same. It is the same course content. The same slides will be repeated. That is the reason you are doing it now, so that you are already taught this material, you are already familiar with the material, you know, you already have some reasonable idea of what is going on, and you already have doubts that are cleared. So, you are already one level advanced to those people, and therefore, you will be able to train them. That is the idea. So, if you do it once again, your own doubts maybe you will get better clarified when we go through. It will also be a little, you have 5 weekends, therefore, there is a lot of time. There will be more tests, there will be more opportunity, and the difficulty then is, remember that there will be about 500 participants. So, things will be a little slower, actually a lot slower, because 500 people may have questions, and so you will have to help them, we will have to help them, more questions, more interaction. But the point is 500 people at the end of those 5 weeks will be trained, and you will be doubly trained.
Fine, sir.
Okay. Thank you. Okay then, thank you very much. I will sign off. Please finish your tests and we will evaluate them as soon as possible, and I think you will get a score immediately. Thank you very much. Thanks for your patience and thank you for coming on a weekend. We really look forward to seeing you on the 17th and 18th and look forward to doing this in earnest with the full participants from your respective colleges. Thank you very much.